family. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord together. Let's stand and worship.
Amen. What a great way to start our morning. 10 a.m. service here in the house of the Lord. It's really good to be together. My name is Dave. I'm one of the pastors here. We want to just take a minute to connect, to highlight a couple of things. First of all, if this is new to you, 10 o'clock's new to everybody, right? But if the church is new to you, we're really glad you're here. We'd love a chance to just say hello personally. I'm going to hang out in the lobby by the welcome area after church, so we're glad you're here. Love to meet you today. For everybody, every time, what do? We use this Connect card, right? So it's digital. It's through the app. The app, if you don't have it, that one on the right there is the Church Center app. It's super useful to know what's going on in the church, to submit a prayer request. But right now we want to invite you to use the Connect card to say, hey, I'm here. So we're glad you're here today. Men, we've got something really cool happening at Camp Harvest next week. I know there's men in the room planning to go. But if you've been thinking about it, trying to wait to decide, the waiting is over. You need to decide, okay? Today is the day. There's no more days to register after today, but it's hosted by Camp Harvest. Some of the guys from our church and other churches are going to go up there. It's happening next weekend. All the information, harvestbible.org. Okay, we do this on Sunday morning because we really need this. We need to come together. We need to come before the Lord. We need to be reminded of who He is and what He's done for us. So I'm going to read a scripture, and then we're going to continue on, and we're going to give our best effort in worship today, all right? Psalm 18:2 says this, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock where I seek refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold." Now, we need to be reminded of that today, and we need to sing it as if we believe it, all right? So let's all continue. We're going to sing these songs of worship to the Lord. Let's do it together.
Christ is my firm foundation, the rock on which I let me down. He's faithful through generations.
church, I don't know. I just have a feeling. I don't know what you are bringing in with you this morning. I don't know if it's anxiety, shame, depression. I don't know if you walked in this morning apathetic. I don't know if you walked in this morning tired. Maybe you're a little bit bitter, maybe you're angry. But can I just remind us all in this moment that Christ is the foundation of our lives. And no matter what we go through, no matter what our feelings may dictate, no matter what our circumstances may dictate, no matter what happens in this life, we can rest assured knowing that we have a God in heaven who loves us, is there for us, and draws near to us. And so, like I said, I don't know what you walked in carrying this morning, but I want to challenge you in this moment. Can we lay it at the feet of Christ? Can we lay our apathy? Can we lay our bitterness, our anger? Can we lay our shame, our sin at the feet of Christ and declare that no matter what happens, Christ, you are my foundation. You're what I build my life on. You're the God in whom I trust. So can we sing that line again? That rain came, wind blew, but my house was built on you. Sing this with me. Rain came, wind blew, but my house was built on you. I'm saved.
Rain came.
You took the nails and took our place. No one else could do what you have done.
Lift up your voice.
One name is higher. One name is stronger.
Amen. Psalm 97:9 says, "For you, O Lord, are most high over all the earth. You are exalted far above all gods." Do we believe that's true? Yeah, we do. It stirs me. Yeah, praise the Lord. It really stirs me to hear you sing it like that. And our lives, we want our lives to be marked by actions that show what we believe. And that's a beautiful thing we just had an opportunity to be a part of. We're going to turn our attention through our worship through giving. And likewise, my giving, your giving should be a statement, an expression of what do I believe? Who's overall? And so we're going to take the opportunity to think about that for a second. On the first weekend of each month, we do what's called a special offering. And this is really trying to train ourselves that it's not all about us. And so this is an opportunity to say, hey, I want to help somebody else. So the special offering today is really twofold. One is our benevolence ministry, which think about benevolence like our church family. So somebody lost a job, somebody had a health crisis, somebody's in a tough spot. Maybe there's a chance for the church to help in a short term, pay rent or pay a medical bill or something like that. That's benevolence. Compassion then is the other thing for the special offering. Compassion is who around us needs to know the love of Jesus Christ and how can we practically care for them. A really practical way we're doing that on some of our campuses is the Hope Center. And why don't you come? Why don't you get food? But we do other things in the communities too that are compassion ministries. So the special offering, which is the first weekend of the month, today's special offering is for benevolence and compassion. So you can give online, digitally, through the day. We just do it for the weekend. Or if you want to be a part of that, there will be ushers at the doors as you leave. That's the special offering, okay? Now, there's our regular offering, and that goes to meet all the needs of the church. And we trust him in that, and as a church family, we get to contribute to that. So that is also available every weekend and throughout the week digitally. You can find all the different ways here. But please don't miss this. This is not checking a box. This is not earning God's favor. This is a statement. I believe God is over all. He's the foundation of my life. I serve him. Great. Then let it be shown in the way we give, all right? So we're going to pray together as we continue on in worship. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day, this gathering, this opportunity to say you are God and you are exalted and we love you and our foundation is Jesus Christ and our life is for you. So, Lord, would you help that to be more and more obvious in the way we live? Obedience, service, generosity, hospitality, Lord, help us to reflect you in all things. And Lord, we're going to lean into your word here in a second. We ask that you would use it to speak to our hearts, that we would respond to you and engage with you. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness and your grace and allowing us to worship you today. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, now don't sit yet. Two things. This is cool. During the 10 o'clock service all summer, we're going to have an opportunity for junior high students to get together with the junior high students. Now, junior high students, you can stay in here with all the old people, or you can go have fun. And so Larry is right here. He leads our student ministry. So now is the time. If you're a sixth grader going into sixth, seventh, eighth, just go ahead, say, see a mom, see a dad. And they're going to be over in a room two halls down. That's going to happen all summer during the 10 o'clock service, all right? So why don't we encourage our junior high students? That's pretty cool. That's great. That's great. Awesome. Awesome. And for everybody else, take a moment and say, hey, glad you came to the 10 o'clock service. Turn around and greet somebody.
Great to see you. Hope you're having a good beginning of the summer. I certainly am. If you are new here, my name is Jeff. I get the privilege of teaching the Bible, and that's what we're going to do in the next few minutes. So if you have a Bible, I want to invite you to open it to 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter chapter 3, we're going to look at a few very difficult to understand verses, but hopefully at the end you will not think that's the case. Before we get started, one of the things I want to make sure that you know about is summertime is a really great opportunity for you to invest in your children. If you're a parent here, you know what it's like. Summer comes around, and you hopefully have lots of things you want to do with your kids in terms of vacations and things like that. But it is a really great opportunity to have your kids involved in some ministry stuff. I actually became a Christian because my parents sent me to Christian camp during the summer times. I grew up in a home that had a kind of a Christian-y background, but certainly not an evangelical kind of one. And so when they sent me to this camp, I came to faith in Christ there eventually. And so I owe most of my Christian experience to God using Christian camp in my life. What's really cool about Harvest is we actually take kids high school and junior high on different weeks to a camp that we used to own, but now we don't own, we use quite frequently. It's called Camp Harvest. It's up in Michigan. So if you are interested at all in that, you really should consider looking at our website. I think the dates are in the early July kind of time frame. I know that we have some financial help if that's like a real challenge for you. I know that there are lots of scholarships and stuff that can be had. There's not actually a really great excuse for you not to pursue this and seek it out, but our youth teams are really excited about serving you and your kids this summer. I want to pray for them, pray for the summer, pray for our kids, pray for the parents who some of you are already losing your minds because you're hoping August comes sooner. So let me pray for us, okay? Father, I'm thankful for your grace and your kindness to us in Christ, and especially thankful, Father, that the most important thing in the lives of our children is that they know you. I know that there's lots and lots of competing interests during the summertime. There's lots of us who get our kids involved in sports and other things, and those are really great activities, Lord. But I do pray that if it's possible, that you would move in the hearts of people to help them commit to maybe a week of time set aside for their kids to know more about Jesus. I pray, Father, that the camps would be filled up and that people who are even considering it, or maybe this is the first time they've heard about it, Lord, that they chase these things down and that you would remind them, Spirit, over the next few days to kind of follow up on that on our website. So, God, I'm thankful for your word. I ask that you bless us now as we study it. Help me to speak clearly and explain this difficult to understand passage. But I pray, Lord, in the end that we would be edified and grow. There's people here who don't know you. I pray, Lord, that they would have their eyes opened. Father, you remove the blinders so that they could see the beauty of Christ. I pray, Father, for those who are here who do already know you, that they would be really built up in Christ because of the things that are said and done here this morning. So we love you. We thank you for your word and for the privilege we have to study it now in Jesus' name. Amen. Speaking of teachers and school, it's the end of the school year, praise God. I mean, it happened in the last week or two, and it always gets me thinking about my experience with my wife, who was a teacher for a lot of years, and the uniquenesses that are part of what it means to be a teacher. You have a very different schedule. It's basically a dead sprint for 9 months, and then you lay down and sleep for three, and then you get up and you do another dead sprint. It's a very different kind of life. One of the things I have noticed over the years about teachers is that they have their own language. If you know a teacher in your life, you'll realize that they are very given over to acronyms. If you sit together with two or three teachers in a room, they'll all talk about the MAPs and the PLTs and the QLSs, and you have no idea what they're talking about the whole time, but they'll say, what was your score in the MAP? They'll say that to your children. They'll send things home, and they don't realize that they're doing this because it's so normal for them to use these little acronyms, but they'll say, your MAP scores this year were this, and I don't know what a MAP score is. I don't care, actually, what a MAP score is. My daughter thinks it's a score that has to do with locating things on maps, but apparently it's not. If you spend time, it's not just them, you know, if you spend time around other people, those who are really involved in baseball, there's all sorts of these little acronyms in baseball as well. I was never really that interested in baseball until my son started playing it a lot, and now I can speak the language, the lingo, but it took me a while, right? I know what an RISP is, but most people are like, what? What's a RISP? War, you know, he's plus four on the war, and you're like, really? Are they going to battle? Wins above replacement is what that means. OPS, RBI, you're like, what? If you know baseball, you're in it, and you sit together with friends who are speaking in baseball terms, you can have good debates with them over these particular numbers, but for the most part, it's an alien language if you don't know a lot about it. Most professions have stuff like this, right? You know this when you go to the doctor and they start using the medical terminology for the things that are wrong with you. You just wish that they would speak about, you know, the thingy on your spleen or whatever. But instead, it's the microorganism that is, you know, like, you're like, I don't know what you're talking about, man. Just tell me. How big is it? Is it a baseball site? You know, like, put it in terms I understand. I actually find in theology, right, when we start talking about the study of God, and especially about Scripture, that a lot of people approach the Bible with the same kind of frustration. They open up the Scriptures, and there are a whole bunch of words there they don't quite understand. Sanctification and justification and propitiation and expiation and ationation and like, Some passages of scripture, in fact, are so hard to understand, we just kind of breeze right through them. Like, we don't know the names, we don't know what's going on. I always find it really encouraging that some of the biblical writers, when they're talking about other biblical writers, they actually make this comment. It's almost a nod to the rest of us who are like, if you guys walk into this the Bible and you feel a little bit weird because you don't know what's going on, because they're using words and phrases that you don't get and they're linking them together, I don't get it either. You know, like there's biblical writers who essentially say that. One of my favorites actually is from Peter. In 2 Peter, he says this about his friend Paul, who wrote a good chunk of the New Testament. He says, and count the patience of our Lord as salvation. This is in 2 Peter 3:15. Count the patience of our Lord as salvation, just as our beloved brother Paul also wrote to you according to the wisdom given him. As he does in all his letters when he speaks in them of these matters, this wisdom. Now, there are some things in them that are hard to understand. I'm like, thank you, Peter. Right? If you sit down and you read the book of Romans, that you're like, I don't get some of the stuff the guy's saying. He doesn't even know what a period is. You just end the sentence, Paul. It just runs on and on and on. Some things are hard to understand, which the ignorant and unstable twist to their own destruction, as they do to the other scriptures. So I get it, guys. Paul's really difficult to understand, and there's some wonky people out there who try to take what he says and twist it to mean something that they think it says, and it would just be a lot easier for just between you and me if he just wrote a little more clearly, you know what I mean? Thank you, Peter. Here's the irony. If you sit down with the book of 1 Peter, written by Peter, and you're like, cool, this guy gets it. He understands that you should be clear and we should be able to understand everything. And then all of a sudden you run into 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. And this is what it says. This is the text we're going to study in the next few minutes. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he went and he proclaimed to the spirits in prison. Wait, what? The who? Wait, what prison are they in? The spirits in prison. Yeah. Because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah. What are we talking about? Wait a minute. There were spirits in the days of Noah that did not obey? What spirits are we talking about? And why are we talking about Noah now? Well, it was while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were brought safely through the water. Everybody got that? Good? All right, just to take it up a notch, baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you. Not as the removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers having been subjected to him. Some of you need to wake up. Hey, right here. It's just a lot of words, Peter. And you know it was in there for a little bit, and some spirits were in there. I know there was an eight. So here's what we want to do. I want to take this very difficult to understand passage, it's a highly debated passage, and I want to try to make it as clear as I can to you. And in it, I just, by the way I want to do that, here's my little outline to try to help you, is I want to zero in on three things that this passage says that Jesus did. Three things that Jesus did. Number one, he brought us to God. Number two, he preached to the spirits. And number three, he subjected the powers. He brought us to God, he preached to the spirit, and he subjected the powers. So let's do the first of those. He brought us to God. So, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. I want to deal first with that word. You know, if you're reading somebody's letter, that you get halfway through and they say, for, you know that there was stuff that came before it. And you need to understand the stuff before it if you're going to make sense of the stuff that it's about to say, because for usually introduces an explanation, right? I'm really excited today. for my baseball team's playing. Or because my baseball team's playing. Well, here's a for, here's a because. So because of what? So if we go back to the verses immediately preceding, so on verse 18, 1 Peter 3, and I want to go back to verse 14 and read through verse 17. Here's what it says. But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you'll be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled, but in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy. So Peter's saying that there's a them out there, a group of people who are going to be slandering or speaking poorly of Christian people, because not because the Christian people are bad people, but in fact they're righteous according to God's rules. But that's the thing. They obey the rules of God as opposed to the rules of the world. When those come into conflict, they look a little bit weird. And so people in the wider society are going to look at the weird Christians and call them weird. They're going to look a little stink eye out of the side of their eye, or they might say things to their friends or make them feel uncomfortable in public places. So don't have any fear of them, though, says Peter. Instead, in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy. In other words, decide that Jesus is the one you're going to serve. Set him apart as being the Lord. He's the only Lord. The world's not the Lord. Jesus is. And always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. There are going to be people who are going to wonder why you act the way you do. Why do you like the things you do? Why do you serve the Lord and call him Lord? Why do you believe that? Why are you upbeat in the midst of suffering? Why do you feel a sense of like, this is not the end of things and I have a future? There's a hope in you. So be ready. Be prepared to make a defense to those people who ask that question. Yet, do it with gentleness and respect, because the temptation's going to be that you're going to do it mean, because they're being mean. Tell me why it is that you believe these things. And you're going to be responding, because you're stupid, right? You're blind, you're dumb, you're going to want to respond in kind. It's the way that it works. But he's saying, no. Do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you're slandered, notice it, when you're slandered, because you will be as Christians, it's the way it is. He says you're aliens and strangers in a foreign land. Those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. They're not going to have reason. Like, they might accuse you of certain things, but that's not going to stick. Because you live well, you are kind to them, you respond in grace as opposed to in revenge. So you get the picture. There's a bunch of people out there who are trying to slander Christian people, and now you're under pressure. So respond with gentleness and respect. For it's better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. For Christ also suffered. The reason you should do this, the reason you should have gentleness and respect, the reason that you should deal kindly with critics and skeptics and anyone who chooses to slander you is because, and you'll say, I'm suffering. The reason you should suffer well is because Jesus suffered once for sins as well. Think about how Jesus handled it when he had all of these people criticizing and mocking, and he had a fake trial. They made stuff up. He put him on the cross. People whose molecules he was holding together by his expressed will, Colossians 1, were walking by, and he was holding their molecules together while they blasphemed him. And he didn't just in his mind go, poof, you're done. Instead, he was kind and generous. He suffered once for sins. He was righteous, and he did it for the unrighteous, just as what you're doing when they criticize you and mock you. You're like, I didn't do anything wrong, right? You're righteous, and you're suffering for the unrighteous. You're putting up with them. Why? Because you want to bring them to God, just like he wanted to bring you to God. You've, in other words, experienced the kindness of Jesus in the way that he's acted, so express that kindness toward the other people who are acting like you used to. Look, I do want to stop here for a minute, and I want to think about this phrase that he might bring us to God. The picture here is basically of, you guys ever seen this? You ever heard of the Sherpas? Sherpas are the people who basically climbed Mount Everest before everybody else. And if you see pictures or watch a movie about Mount Everest these days or people climbing up Mount Everest, one of the things you'll know is that there are actually trails that the Sherpas have built into the mountain, you know, with like little posts in the right spot. So a Sherpa or a group of Sherpas at one point decided, you know what we're going to do is we're going to climb this mountain, we're going to brave the trail, we're going to put all these little posts up all along the path to the very top of the mountain, and when we get to the top of the mountain, we're going to come back down, and then we're going to take and lead these people and bring them to the top of the mountain. What this passage is saying is that this is what Jesus has done. He has braved the trail through death and into resurrection. He has gone to the top of the mountain, and now he's come back down, and he is grabbing us by the hand, and he is leading this along the way. He's bringing us to God. Listen, it's not Jesus at the top of the mountain going, "Good luck! Hope you may. I put some posts out. Just look for them." It's not that. It's Jesus walking along, holding the hand, leading you to God. To who? To God. Because that's what the top of the mountain is in Christianity, is Jesus is bringing us to God. Jesus is not bringing us to heaven, even though he is. He's ultimately bringing us to God. That's why heaven is great, is because God is there. Not just that heaven has all sorts of cool goodies, but that we get God. This is a really important point. The treasure of Christianity is not so much heavenly bliss as it is God himself. The goal, in fact, of the Christian life is that you would get God. Not that you would get money, as some stupid preachers say. Not that you would get some sort of peace, even though that will probably happen. Not that you will get heavenly bliss with all of the goodies, even though that will happen, but that you'll get God. Look, I really want to press this, and I'll show you why in just a second, but if you go to the end of the story, Revelation 21. By the way, if you don't want this to be revealed to you, like if you're waiting to read the end of the book later, just close your ears for a second. This is the end. Here's what happens to us in the end. John, the apostle, he wrote Revelation, and he saw a vision, and this is what he describes at the end of the book. He says, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth," that's the ones that we're on right now, "the first heaven and first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people.'" So you've been to weddings, you will go to weddings this summer. One of the things that will happen in the wedding is they will close the doors at the back, or maybe you're outside and she'll hide behind a tree or something. But there is a moment when the bride is revealed, and the doors will swing open, and she will stand there with her weeping father. As they walk down the aisle, I actually officiated my own son's wedding a couple of weeks ago, which was a very bad idea. It's not easy to do. But you get the greatest view when you're officiating. You see them, you see the bride come down. And when you go to this wedding, the whole wedding is meant to evoke an image in your mind of what will be for you one day, Christian. One day you will enter into the room and you will walk forward down the aisle to the beloved. Because that's why you're there, is to go and to join God. God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Now look, you and I, this is the part that we usually quote from there, right? He'll wipe away every tear from your eyes. But I quoted the whole passage so that you'll see that the actual great thing that's focused on by John is that you get God. And the effect of you getting God is that there's no more tears. And death shall be no more. And neither shall there be mourning or crying or pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. You can just picture this for a minute. You know, you're at the wedding. You're gonna enter. You know, the bride comes in. They swing the doors open, and she starts walking with her father down the aisle, and she's there, and her face is beaming in joy because of all the cool things her new husband's gonna give her. Right? She gets up to him and she looks at him and says, I can't believe I'm out of debt because I married a rich guy. You have a nice house. I get to live in a house. No, that never happens. She's crying and in joy because she's enraptured by him. And that's what Christians get is God himself. John Piper, in his wonderful little book, God is the Gospel, he put this very well and put a point on it that I'm trying to make. He said, the critical question for our generation and for every generation is this. If you could have heaven with no sickness and with all the friends you ever had on earth and all the food you ever liked and all the leisure activities you ever enjoyed and all the natural beauties you ever saw, all the physical pleasures you ever tasted, and no human conflict or any natural disasters, could you be satisfied with heaven if Christ were not there? Christ did not die to forgive sinners who go on treasuring anything above seeing and savoring God. And people who would be happy in heaven if Christ were not there will not be there. The gospel is not a way to get people to heaven. It is a way to get people to God. You are an idolater if you treat God as he is a means to something else. He is either the goal or he is nothing. He is not your subcontractor. You did not hire him to fix your life. To become a Christian is to submit yourself to God himself and his son Jesus Christ and to say, above all things, I want you. In every event in my life, I want to look for how it is that I'm getting you out of this. I'm scared because there are so many of us Christians who actually are just treating God as a means to another end. He's what we call instrumental. He's an instrument. He's like a straw that we use to suck up the shake. But when the straw breaks, we're mad at it, aren't we? Because that's the real question in the end, isn't it? I mean, how do you know? This seems like a very pedantic or small distinction I'm making here. How do you know that you want God above all things? Or that you're using him to get something else? Well, it's actually not that hard. when I lose comfort or I don't get what I pray for, and I'm angry with the Lord, it's quite possible that I'm treating him as a means to something else as opposed to the end himself. Because that's how it works when you contract somebody. If they come in and they're there to fix your kitchen or to build a deck at your house, and the deck is produced, but it's not exactly what you wanted, you get on the phone and you talk to them and you're upset with them and you're saying, I don't want to pay you because of the things that you did, or I've already paid you so much, you need to come back and you need to fix it according to my specifications. Because the person themselves, they're a means to the deck. If you get mad at God because he didn't give you the perfect spouse, if you get mad at God because he's not answered your prayer for victory in sports, if you get mad at God because he's done whatever it is that you don't like, and you shake your fist at him, as I am very wont to do, you shake your fist at him and you say, oh God, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? This is outrageous. I'm not going to follow you if this is the way it works. I'm going to tell you that you actually think that God's a means to another end. And your real God, not God, it's the other end. So how do you respond when you don't get what you want? It can tell you an awful lot about the state of your soul. Jesus suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. All right, here's the second thing that I'm going to point out that Jesus did. He preached to the spirits. So look at verse 18 with me. I'm going to read it again, okay? So for Christ, remember, because all these people are going to be criticizing and all that kind of stuff. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, which is what you'll be doing, is when you put up with people who are criticizing, you're righteous, but you're suffering for the unrighteous, that they might be brought to God. Jesus being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. Now, the way this language is being used here, Peter's essentially saying that what happened with Jesus when he died is he died in regards to the realm of the flesh, meaning the world that we inhabit right now, Peter calls the fleshly realm. It is the realm that is governed by the flesh. But when Jesus rises from the dead, he is risen in the realm of the spirit. That does not mean he doesn't have a physical body. It means that the body that he had, like you and I have right now, is one that's appropriate for the flesh. And the body that he rises in when he rises from the dead is the one that's appropriate for the realm of the spirit, the age to come. So Jesus was put to death in the flesh, but he was made alive in this body that was appropriate for the realm of the spirit, in which, in this body, he went and he proclaimed to the spirits in prison. Let's pray. Now, there's a lot of debate about what this means. There are some people in the history of the church who've been like, see, purgatory. He goes and he proclaims the spirit in prison. There's some people who come along and say, see, this is proof that there's a second chance for everybody, because these spirits are people who died and Jesus goes and he proclaims to them. See, that's what's going to happen. You're going to die one day and all the people who didn't believe in Jesus are going to have another chance, because Jesus is the kind of God who goes and he proclaims to the spirits, the people in prison, the disembodied souls in prison. That's not what Peter means. What Peter means, number one, this word proclaimed, is there's a way that you can say proclaim the gospel. In fact, they coined a term in the New Testament called euangelizo, and it means to gospel someone. They turned it into a verb, right? It's to good news someone. If I'm going to go and I'm going to preach the good news, I'm euangelizoing you. But then there's the general word for the proclamation of something. That's what this word is. Peter avoids the one about the gospel. So he's saying here that he proclaimed and not the gospel, though. He proclaimed to the spirits this word, because it's plural. Every other place that you find the word spirits, plural, it refers to angels and demons. Okay? To the non-physical part of the immaterial world serving Satan or God. So, Jesus, in his resurrected body that was appropriate for the new heavens and new earth, he went and he proclaimed, after he rose from the dead, he proclaimed something, not the gospel, to the spirits, these disembodied souls who were in prison. Why? Well, because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared. Okay, so what is this referring to? Thank you for asking. Here, if you go back to Genesis chapter 6, this is the story of Noah. But before you get into the moment where the ark, you know, they all get in the ark and God floods the world, but everyone knows that story, right? There's a bunch of people who were judged. Noah built this ark over a period of time. And, you know, the people around were like, you're stupid. And Noah just kept building the ark. And you should repent because there's going to be a massive flood. But only 8 of them did, Noah and his family. They get in the ark. And there's only 8 people who are in the ark. And they're the only ones who are saved. And everybody else is destroyed. Before any of that happens, verse 1. Genesis 6, when man began to multiply in the face of the land and daughters were born to them, the sons of God, it's a big debate over what that is, but our passage is essentially arguing that these are angelic beings. The sons of God saw that the daughters of man were attractive. And they, the sons of God, these angelic beings, they took as their wives any that they chose. And then the Lord said, my spirit shall not abide in man forever, for he is flesh. His days shall be 120 years. The Nephilim, which were the children of this union between the angels and the women, the Nephilim were on the earth in these days and also afterward when the sons of God came to the daughters of men and they bore children to them. These were the mighty men who were of old, the men of renown, right? Big, strong, capable military guys who were the product or the progeny of angelic and human union. The Lord saw then that the wickedness of man was great in the earth. I want you to notice that what the author here is doing is he's saying, look, it's gotten so bad that even the angels are coming down and ruining everything. So people have started to sin, and their sin had reached such a high level that they're even having sex with angels. The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was so great in the earth and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord regretted he had made man on the earth and it grieved him to his heart. So the Lord said, I'm going to blot out man whom I've created from the face of the land, man and animals, creeping things and birds of the heavens, for I'm sorry that I've made them. But Noah found favor in the eyes of the Lord. And then we go into the story of Noah, how God saves them. But here's what Peter's trying to argue. Look, there is a demonic influence. There's a demonic influence into the sin of humanity. People are sinful, yes, but the immaterial evil world fans that evil, that wickedness into a fire. Now, Jude, he actually talks about this. So in the New Testament, Jude talks about, because the question you start having is, well, what did God do anything with these particular angels? Did he judge them? What did he do to them? Jude verse 6, it's only one chapter long. And the angels who did not stay within their own position of authority, but left their proper dwelling, he has kept in eternal chains under gloomy darkness until the judgment of the great day. So God took those angels and he placed them into a prison somewhere. What Peter is saying is then Jesus comes along, he dies, he rises again, he goes and he proclaims to those angels in prison. What does he proclaim? Victory. He goes and he preaches victory. He basically goes and he mocks them. What's up? You tried to ruin my world, eh? Well, look what I did. Check it out, resurrected body. And everybody in me is gonna have a resurrected body. It didn't work. You can see him like walking in front of the prison bars. Hello, what's up? You know, want a candy? Psych, you know, like. That's what Peter's saying is that Jesus, these beings that try to ruin everything, they couldn't even destroy it because Jesus is Lord. Now, hold that, because he's going to end with that. That's the main point of what he's trying to do here. But I do want to talk to you for just a second about the fact that demonic powers push human sinfulness forward. There is an immaterial world. My naturalistic-minded friends. I know, we're people of science. Yes, yes. Isn't science great? Science is really great in testing things in the material world, isn't it? The question that you have to ask is everything real just material? So science is awesome for doing the thing science is intended to do, but it can't do everything. You can't put an angel in a beaker, guys. There is an immaterial, we've been taught to believe that there is no such thing as an immaterial world, but I'm telling you that these passages are basically saying, no, there is an immaterial world, and it has infiltrated our world. And so the sin that is part of you and me, and the thing, we were born in sin, that sinfulness is set alight. It is fueled by wicked forces in the immaterial realm. I can prove this to you. I don't even need the passage you were studying. Here you go. Ephesians chapter 6, the Apostle Paul writes, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. I know you feel, and I feel, like we're fighting back against the governing authority, meaning the current president or the local governor, or like whatever. I know we're like, oh, that's the person I don't like. Or I know we feel like the person who's criticizing Christianity, that's the one I don't like. Ah, they're fighting us. But he's saying is, no, I get it. It looks like we're fighting against flesh and blood, but behind the flesh and blood, there is an empowering presence that is motivating it. And that's our fight. The physical is just a tool for the non-physical power. Ephesians 2, verse 1, before you were a Christian, you were dead in trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air. The spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. There is a devil, there is a Satan. And he is the one who the unbeliever follows. They might not even know he exists, but he's the one who sets the course of this age, and they follow in lockstep with him and what he defines. He gives them all sorts of ideas as to what's good, true, and beautiful, and they're all just stinking lies. In fact, 2 Corinthians 4, Paul writes, even if our gospel is veiled, it's veiled to those who are perishing. See, in their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. The person that you're speaking to who doesn't like Christianity or doesn't like Christians is being controlled and motivated by a whole system that was set up by Satan. And I know the temptation is to be like, oh, I can't stand you, non-believing person. You're not right, but you're talking to somebody who is blind. And you're saying, oh, look at the sun. Isn't it glorious? And they're like, there is no sun. Watch your leg. You're walking through a minefield of chairs in your room. And they're like, there's no chairs. Ow. That was a chair. No, it wasn't. What do you do when you meet somebody who's blind? Do you walk up to them and yell at them? Come on, figure it out, man. It's the sun. It's right there. Maybe if I talked louder, the sun. No, you're not going to fix it. What needs to happen is that they need to be given sight, which we have a God who said, let light shine out of darkness. But look, Peter's point with this is to say, look, the reason that you can treat an unbeliever with dignity and respect and be patient with them is because there are powers at play here that are not flesh and blood. And they're moving them. And there should be a kind of compassion that comes upon the Christian person to say, I understand. If I were in your state too, I'd be screaming and angry. But oh God, give them eyes to see. Now I said that the main point of this passage was about the lordship of Jesus, and it is. So let's finish with that. He subjected the powers. He subjected the powers. Okay, so I'm gonna walk through the whole passage, see if you can follow it. I hope that you'll walk out thinking, okay, I got a little bit better feel for what this is saying. Here we go. For, because of all these people who are slandering and stuff, for Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God. And that's what you and I are involved in doing, is bringing people to God, even though we might think we're in the right and think they're in the wrong. Jesus was the same, but he was patient and forbearing. Jesus being put to death in the flesh, being made alive in the spirit with a body that was appropriate for the new heavens, new earth, the spiritual realm. And it's in that body that he went and he proclaimed victory, taunting to the spirits in prison. Those spirits are the, you know, Genesis 6, angels that left their proper dwelling and came and sinned with women, and Nephilim were the product because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which a few, that is eight persons, so even though Noah was preaching broadly and saying, hey, you need to repent, you need to repent, you need to repent, only eight people responded, and they were all his family. And they were brought safely through the water. The ones who responded were brought safely through the water. Baptism, which, see this word, corresponds to this. This is a Greek word, antitype, antitupas. And what it means is, okay, let me give you an example. In the Old Testament, the ark and the Noah story was an example of what we now experience in baptism. So follow his line. God was gonna judge the whole world. He declared it. And then he sent Noah, and Noah proclaimed repentance, but only eight people responded. They got into an ark that was submerged into water and then raised up above, so that they were saved by being in the ark. In baptism, what you do is you respond to the message that there is going to be a judgment coming on all the world, and you respond by placing yourself into Jesus Christ by faith, saying, I give up. I can only survive with you, Jesus. And you place yourself into Jesus' ark, and you get, what happens in baptism? You get submerged into the water, and you get raised up above to new life. So baptism now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because Jesus has been raised from the dead and you're in Jesus, the ark, you are above the waters, above the judgment, and have new life forever. Even though everybody else is judged because they didn't respond. You can hear Peter's, what he's doing here is he's trying to say, look, I know that you guys feel like you're the only ones around, but Noah had a group of people who were the only ones around too, and they responded and they experienced life. So even though the whole world would yell at you and say you're wrong and terrible, he's like, there's a remnant. There were eight then. There might be 8,000 now, 8 million, or maybe just eight. But if you remain faithful to Jesus, you will see that the Lord who reigns will return in victory. He already proclaimed it to the angels. He's gone into heaven, and he's at the right hand of God, the seat of authority, with angels, there they are, the angels and authorities and powers having been subjected to him. He is Lord of all, he is Lord of everyone, and what he says will come to pass because he's the one who said it and will accomplish it. So listen close. I've finished all of this with this point. And this is what Peter's trying to get to. Even if everything is going sideways now, even if everyone in the entire world is mocking the Christian for building a boat in the middle of the desert, you guys are so stupid, judgment. Even though all of that is going on, the victory's already won. We're on the right side. We have the winning team. We have the winning captain. And those who are in Christ will join the taunt over the powers that oppress so much. Okay, so best I can do to bring this all to a summation is just a picture. I'll finish with this. So I've been watching the baseball. You guys got to watch the baseball. The college baseball is crazy. They get to the end of these games in the college baseball, a World Series or the tournament that leads to, it's like March Madness. They get to the end of these games and they're often tied. And there's a team, one team has the last at bat. And, you know, the one guy, an unexpected guy will hit a home run or something. And, you know, errors will be made, and they call that a walk-off, where the game's just over once the guy finishes it. Well, my team, over the last few days, has had a couple of walk-offs wins, and they're the best moment in sports, is when your guy's up there, and you're feeling all this fear and trepidation. Oh, my goodness, we could lose, and that'll be the end of our season. And then a guy goes up, and he takes a swing, and it just starts soaring, and you stand up on the TV, and the commentator says, could it? And then all of a sudden it goes over the fence and you scream, ah! Several times I have almost fainted because I have yelled so loud about this and I fall down in the chair, you know? Right. On one of occasions, there's a guy on the team that I support and he doesn't play. He didn't play at all. I think he saw him for once this whole season. Anyway, our guy, he hits this home run, this walk-off home run, and the guy who never plays, he jumps up out of the dugout. Instead of running over with the team who's all celebrating, he goes over in front of the other dugouts, and he's like, what's up, you know, L-S-U-S-F, you know, he's doing this dance. Now, I'm watching it and going, come on, man, right? They're sitting there going, what did you do? But listen, it doesn't matter what he did. It doesn't matter. At the end of the season, if they win the title, he will get a ring. He did it because his team did it. The fact that he was in the team meant that he was going to experience all the accolades that the team got. The guy who hit the home run, he was the hero, but it didn't matter. What he did was on behalf of the whole team, and everyone on the team now can run off to the field and go, this is our situation. You know that, right? There will be a day, and Jesus will return, and he has taken that bat, and he is gonna Barry Bonds that thing over the center field wall, and there's no doubt about it. He's called his shot. He's already proclaimed it to the angels and powers. I'm taking you yard, man. You know, and Satan's gonna throw his best, you know, curveball, fastball, slide. I don't care what it is, and Jesus is gonna go,
pop, and he's going to run the bases, and we're going to win. We will win the game. And you and I, we will jump out of that dugout, and we will run over. And together with Christ, we will be able to stand in front of all the oppressive powers in the history of the world and go, what's up? What is up? I'm right here. Not because you hit the home run, but because you were part of the team with the captain who hit the home run. So our temptation is to sit on the bench in the eighth inning, worried, we're behind. We're so behind. What's gonna happen? We're never gonna win. I already read you the end of the book, man. Why are we so worried? On the edge of the bench, our captain is sitting next to us on the thing of, yeah, I already been here, man. Piece of cake, piece of cake. All you gotta do is keep playing. All you gotta do is keep playing. Keep getting up every day, going out into the field and doing the things that God's called you to do. You just keep playing, and then one day he will return in the clouds and victory will be ours. So live now like that's true. It's true. All Jesus is seated at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers having been subjected to him. Let me pray. Father, I'm not a good player. You know, I don't win the games. And I feel like most of the time the games are hard, and I'm losing, and things aren't going the way I want them to. And I get mad, and I shake my fist at you and say, what are you doing? I admit that you're giving me the greatest gift, and that is you. That every weakness and difficulty that I experience is there because you want me to rely more on you and know you better, which is the greatest treasure there is. But I pray, Lord, in these difficult moments for all of us as we're walking through the days of our life and going out on those fields every single day, wherever it is that you have us playing, I pray, Lord, that you would grant us a vision for the days ahead, and that the hope of eternity and victory that will be ours would infiltrate our hearts and our minds and our souls to the point, Lord, where the depression and frustration and sadness will dissipate and we will see the glorious future. So keep us faithful, we pray. Help us to keep walking, we pray. Give us joy, we pray. We will see the power of our God. We pray it in Jesus' good name, amen.
Amen. Let's stand as we respond.
Song within me, reaching from
Anybody glad you came to church today? My goodness, yeah, yeah, yep. The thought that our Savior is the hero, is the captain, has won the day, has won the battle, is incredible. And the question obviously becomes, am I on his team? Have I turned from my sin? Have I embraced him by faith? If that's unresolved for you, please, today, get it settled. Come to him. Ask him for forgiveness. He's our hope. He's our Savior. If the game feels long and you're weary and you're tired and you're, I don't know what's going to happen, that's why we pray for each other. So come up front here. We'd love to pray for you before you go today. If you're new, so glad you came today. We'd love a chance to say hello out here in the lobby. But we're going to gather again next week, Lord willing, but we have all these hours until then. We go and play for him. We go and live for him. Lord, help us as we go out on mission for him this week. Just remember, you are loved.